During the years leading up to the Spanish Civil War, Spain was a divided monarchy. There were political, regional, and ideological divisions. The two most influential parties that existed leading up to the Spanish Civil War were the Republicans and the Nationalists. The Nationalists fought to conserve what Spain had always been, a conservative monarchy, ruled through the power of the church. The Republicans, however, aspired to move forward into a more democratic society with equal rights and a separated church and state. Despite the best efforts of the Republicans for political reforms, Spain was still stuck in the past. Spain was technologically in the 19th century, while they faced the ideologies and political upheavals of the 20th century. The war was the culmination of years of struggle between groups of Spanish political parties with different ideas about what Spain was supposed to be. Even the Nationalists were split into different groups. There were the Carlists, who came from the Basque Country and wanted a church-supported state, the Falange, who were a group of fascists, the Monarchists, who wanted to see their former king, Alfonso, return to the throne, and the CEDA, which were a group of conservatives. There were also communist parties and anarchist movements in Spain at this time. However, the topic of our discussion relates to the four right-wing parties who would easily mesh with the ideals of General Francisco Franco, also known as the Caudillo, which means leader. The Caudillo was a military leader in Spain before the onset of the Civil War. He was one of few officers who took their job seriously and acted professionally. This sort of no-nonsense attitude put Franco in good graces with his superiors and was soon promoted to the rank of captain, the youngest in the Spanish army at that time. Not many years passed before Franco climbed the ranks and became a general at age 33. The Spanish people, united in a regime of law, is the national state. Its political form, following the immutable laws of the national movement, is the traditional Catholic, social, and representative monarch. The political struggle in Spain, as well as Franco's apparent initial success, led to some important questions. What were Franco's ideologies? How did his ideologies affect his rule during the Civil War and his successful dictatorship afterward? Franco's ideological views are complex and cannot simply be stated in one sentence. He was a Catholic, a fascist, and a conservative. These three ideological aspects of his political career positively affected the general opinion of his decisions, while other aspects of his views were subject to change in order to pursue his mission of saving Spain from communism. In Franco's dealings with the church, he was very calculated. He knew that the group of Carlists in the north would not follow him unless he was publicly dedicated to the Catholic Church. It was said of Franco that he had not been particularly devout, but the persecution of priests in the Red Zone had aroused his latent emotions, and the influence of his wife may well have hastened his own evolution toward a new religiosity. It was clear that Franco held all of the notions of being religious to gain the support of his followers, but it was clearly a political scheme to achieve victory over the Republicans. This tactic was certainly effective. In a matter of only a few months, Franco had earned the full support of the Carlists through his feigned dedication to the Catholic Church. In one of Franco's writings, which has been called his 12 Principles, he writes, "The Spanish nation considers, as a stamp of honor, the acknowledgement of the laws of God, following the doctrine of the Holy Catholic, Apostolic, and Roman Church, the only true faith, inseparable from the national conscience, which inspires its legislation." During Franco's dictatorship after the Civil War, his rightist conservative policies were evident.
Franco had a large following, but his restrictions on his people were severe. He only allowed us to practice Catholicism. He banned us from speaking our own languages outside of our homes, and even created a police force to spy on us. His own people. Franco was a totalitarian dictator, and his regime proved that.
Made an excellent springboard for a religiously driven campaign by Franco. In the spring of 1936, right before the onset of the war, the Republicans murdered thousands of priests and nuns, burned down churches, and otherwise laid waste to the proponents and infrastructure of the Catholic Church. One of the pillars of the Republican movement was the breakdown of the church, and its replacement was secularism. It has been estimated that throughout the first few months of the Civil War, more than 6,800 Catholic clergy members were murdered. Franco saw this as an opportunity to unite the four rightist political factions under a common cause. Another part of Franco's genius was his involvement abroad. Franco knew of the military power of nearby Germany and Italy. He quickly signed a friendship treaty with Germany and made ties with Mussolini. Hitler and Franco's relationship was not ideally personal, but rather political. Hitler had seen Spain as an asset to Germany because of the pre-existing hostility between Spain and France. It was not fairly difficult for Hitler to transition his ideals into Spain, but the Spanish elites had previous respect for German philosophy and intellect. When Hitler was proposed by Franco's representatives to aid the military rebellion in Spain, he was initially surprised. Hitler began his intervention in the Spanish Civil War in order to stop the spread of communism, but did not fully commit his troops to fight alongside the rebels. Mussolini was a more direct ally to the rebellious side of Spain due to his interest in maintaining the strength of Italy's foreign policy. On March 31, 1934, Mussolini signed an agreement that the Italian government would support the Spanish monarchist movement by providing weapons, financing, and military training in order to defeat the Republicans. Hitler supplied the rebels with aircraft and troops, totaling 92 planes and 3,900 men on November 6 of 1936. At this point, Hitler's support had outnumbered the support of Mussolini's. Hitler and Mussolini respected a military agreement that allowed them both to represent themselves mutually during the war in Spain. After Hitler and Mussolini acknowledged Franco as the commander of the government of Spain on November 18th of 1936, Hitler's interest in aiding Spain ceased. Some of Franco's critics at the time said he was being taken advantage of by Mussolini and Hitler, based on the fact that Hitler had no care of the impact and outcome of the war, only that Spain would abide by German policies. After 1938, Hitler had zero intentions of supporting Spain, leaving Mussolini as Franco's sole ally. One of Franco's best qualities, and one that made him a successful general and later dictator, was his military leadership. By military aspect, the death of General Sanjurjo gave reason for Franco's rise to power in Spain. After Sanjurjo's death, Franco was able to take control of the 47,000 men in the colonial army that were by far the most thoroughly trained and toughest in all of Spain.
Franco has been the inspiration of all generals in chief during the Morocco campaigns, of the reconquests of Melilla, the Jaén withdrawal, and the taking of Alhucemas. Franco was the man who saved the situation during the Republican Rebellion at Jaca. He was the inspiration and director of the suffocation of the Asturias Revolt. Franco is the general and chief of the army in today's liberation of Spain. He is the number one strategist of this century. He reads the map and decides with genial clarity. He never commits a mistake.
By the fall of 1936, Franco was called chosen head of wartime government by his military colleagues and had undertaken personally to refer to himself as head of the state. The generals in the Spanish army had a lot of respect for the Caudillo. What made Franco so successful through the Civil War and in his dictatorship afterwards were his strong ideological views.
The national community is based on man as the carrier of eternal values and on the family as the base of social life. But the individual and collective interests always have to be subordinated to the communal good of the nation.
Franco believed very strongly in a unified Spanish mind. It was his first goal when he was attempting to unify the political factions. He had to satiate the monarchists, the fascists, and the Catholics. In the end, he was very successful and defeated the Republicans and established his dictatorship. Today in Spain, opinions of Franco's leadership are divided. Some say he was terrible for crushing Spain's chance at democracy through the Republican regime. Others call him a hero for saving the Spanish Catholic Church and protecting Spain from the onslaught of the communist regime. No matter what your beliefs about his regime, no one can deny that Franco was very successful in accomplishing his desired goals.